Judah. They wanted judgment. They wanted righteousness. And God is very, very interested in those two truths. I think sometimes as believers, we create concepts when we try to simplify what God is, and we sometimes miss what God says He is. I have heard it preached adamantly so that God is love. And every attribute of God comes from the truth or the fact that God is love. And I don't disagree with that in the least bit. God is certainly loving. I say many times that as I grow to know the Lord more, I realize more and more how much God loves me. And I'm so much in awe when I realize that God loves me, because one of the things that really is beyond comprehending is that as much as I can understand God's love for me, He loves me more than that. And you could say about God's love is greater. God had a plan, a special plan for Judah, for Israel and Judah, but God is working specifically in Judah. The kings to whom Isaiah was the prophet to were the kings of Judah, Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah. And that was the godly kingdom, the godly part of Israel. Of course, Judah would have been the center of worship with Jerusalem. And God loved Judah and used His people, the nation of Israel, has always used them, and had a special call for them, namely to give us His Son. God isn't done with Israel either. We'll see that in our text this evening. But last week we saw that God wanted from Judah, He wanted judgment. But instead of judgment, oppression. And God wanted from Judah righteousness, but instead of righteousness, a cry. Friend, I wonder how much judgment and how much righteousness is part of our makeup or part of the way that we think, especially when we concern ourselves with what God thinks about us. And so we are going to be in a very interesting passage of Scripture this evening. We'll just read verses 9 through 13. We'll cover all of Isaiah 6. This is Isaiah's call. It's interesting that it comes all the way this far in, really, to the introduction. We really are just finishing up the introduction portion of Isaiah in chapter 6. So this is Isaiah's call this evening. We will look at verse 9 and read to verse 13. The Bible says, "And He said, Go and tell this people, Hear ye indeed, but understand not. And see ye indeed, but perceive not. Make the heart of this people fat, and make their ears heavy, and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their heart, and convert, and be healed. Then said I, Lord, how long? And He answered, Until the cities be wasted without inhabitant, and the houses without man, and the land be utterly desolate, and the Lord have removed men far away, and there be a great forsaking in the midst of the land. But yet in it shall be a tenth, and it shall return, and shall be eaten, as a teal tree, and as an oak, whose substance is in them, when they cast their leaves, so the holy seed shall be the substance thereof." Father, please help us tonight, not only to understand the Scripture, but even, Father, as we understand the Scripture, to understand You, Your heart, and Your call. Lord, I pray for every one of us this evening. As we look at understanding Isaiah's ministry, we would ask the very personal question, what is my ministry? Who am I? And God, what place, what stage and phase am I at in my life? And I pray that as we see the answers to these questions, with the way that You worked in another's life, that we would understand that though we are different individuals called at a different time, that we serve the same God and we can expect many of the same things from You and in our ministry that Isaiah expected in his lifetime. We pray for Your help now in understanding this. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, this is Isaiah's sharing how he came to be the prophet in Judah. And as he's explaining this, we see that he takes us to the specifics. We're introduced in Isaiah to the fact that one of the kings that he was a prophet during the reign of was Uzziah. And we did say at the beginning of our series that Isaiah had an exceptional ministry, because much of his ministry, actually, he had two things that distinguished himself from other prophets of God. One, he actually served under some good kings. Most of the prophets of the Lord went to warn evil kings. and to say things like, "Thou art the man," or "These are the consequences if you will not yield yourself to God." But Isaiah actually was privileged to serve under some good kings. Namely, one of the ones we think of would be Hezekiah, and Uzziah would not have been one who would have been very open to the ministry of Isaiah. As well, Isaiah was privileged because he would have had royal lineage. And so he actually would have been related to the palace. He would have been able to access places where others perhaps wouldn't have had the right to go to. For instance, Amos, who would have been a sycamore farmer. And he would have been a very, even as you read the Hebrew language, and I'm not a Hebrew scholar, I've had 2 years of Hebrew, and the only thing I say about that is that if somebody tells you after 2 years of training in Hebrew that they know Hebrew, they're lying about it. I read commentators all the time that they transliterate the Hebrew word and say, the word for this is this in the Hebrew. And of course, Hebrew is a picturesque language, but there's no grammatical or exegesis in what they say. And so I don't claim to be a Hebrew scholar at all, but I do know this. I know when someone else is pretending to be and is not. And also, I can tell you that Amos was a very backward sort of fellow from just the way that he was definitely a farmer. He would have been a redneck. He would have been inspired with redneck tendencies to write the scripture. And so he would have been very different from Isaiah. Isaiah would have been a man who would have been related to the king, who would have had access to the palaces. And really, in spite of the fact that much of his ministry condemned Israel, or specifically Judah, would have been relatively well received, not persecuted too much until the end. And so here we see Isaiah going back after he has really given an indictment of the way that God views Judah. And last week we kind of encapsulated that, or came up with a synopsis. God looked at Judah as saying, I wanted judgment and I wanted righteousness. Instead, I got oppression and a cry. And that really summarizes, if you'll read the rest of chapter 5 of Isaiah, that really summarizes the state of affairs in Israel. You know that we can relate, cannot we, today, to much of that? It's surprising to me how much outrage there is, but how little concern there is with the right or the wrong of the thing. It's easy to talk about politics right now because there's a lot of it right now, isn't there? And it's just really in the forefront of everyone's minds. But let's not talk about the political scene. Let's talk about the church. I'm surprised sometimes at how little concern there is for what God thinks about something versus the just pragmatic approach. The church people oftentimes are very pragmatic. You can tell based on their attendance sometimes. You say, what do you mean, Pastor? Well, let me give you for instance. Did you know that there's not a rule in the Bible about how many times you have to attend church in a week? There's no Bible rule like 4 times, 6 times, 14 times, whatever. There's no thou shalt, you know, and then the exceptions for those things. The Bible just simply says that in the New Testament, we're not to forsake the assembling of ourselves together. And it's interesting that on the basis of that truth, that Christians reason this. I've had people say this, well, how much? How much forsaking is too much? You ever had somebody ask that question? You know, forsake means to leave your brother or sister in a lurch. Sort of like playing tug of war and everybody dropping the rope with the guy that's right next to the pit still hanging on and he gets dragged in. That's the idea of forsaking. How much is too much? It's amazing to me when I get people to be honest with me how pragmatic people are. In other words, many times Christians have determined, well, you know, I won't have dire consequences if I miss for these reasons. Things won't be too bad if, you know, and they figure out how much is acceptable and then go with that. As opposed to how much faithfulness demonstrates a passion or a love for God. We ask the wrong question all the time, don't we? The question really ought to be how much is too much. Not how much is is not enough. Christians are that way sometimes in giving. It kind of surprises me. I've always said, I don't mean a slight to anyone or don't mean to be unkind about it, but I've always personally believed that tithers are cheap. You know what I mean? I've always felt like tithers are cheap because they're minimalist. In other words, what am I required to do? Tithers are not givers, I promise you. A person who is hung up on tithing, tithing is just the minimum. Really, the question ought to be, how much can I give? Not how much do I have to give. In other words, it's all God's. It all belongs to Him. And I really feel like there's a connection with God's blessing to giving. Don't you? Anybody here feel like that? I feel like there's a connection having God's blessing in my life to giving. And so logically then, oughtn't we to say, well, if it could be eternal, or if I could have God's blessing, I'd like a lot. But we're really pragmatic about it, aren't we, actually? We're really kind of like, well, how much do I have to give so that God won't, judge me for it and make me lose my job, or, make my house go into foreclosure, or somebody sue me, or whatever. You ever notice, you ever notice that when you have a grudging spirit, God doesn't bless it? Ever notice that? Here's something I've noticed. I never have a surplus. I don't. I don't have like a slush fund. My wife and I don't. I'm just going to bare my soul and tell you about my personal finances right now. I don't have a slush fund of money that just has come in extra and I haven't known what to do with. Because whatever God gives me, He gave it to me to do something with. And it's really true. There have been a few times in my life when, you call it a windfall, where something went right instead of going wrong. Maybe you expected to have an expense and you didn't have one. Or, you actually got paid for something you didn't expect to get paid for or whatever, and I had a windfall. It's always amazing that it's always like, here's the windfall. Oh, by the way, here's the need. And they always go hand in hand. It's like, I always know God gives me something to supply a need, right? Because God didn't give me to accumulate or to keep in the bank or to have. He gave to me so I can give. I'm a steward. That's what a steward does. A steward allocates resources and uses them in the most effective way possible. But Christians are kind of backward about that whole matter. Christians really are more like, what do I have to give? Brother Lee was teaching on biblical stewardship a while back. One of the things that kind of made an impression on me, something that I hadn't really thought through before, I think he's right about. He said, it's really interesting, or one of the things that he noted as a symptom that you're not giving enough was that you give at the end of the month instead of the beginning, or at the end of the paycheck instead of at the beginning of it. I hadn't really thought about that before. I'll be honest with you, my parents taught me to give. So a lot of the things that people do, but I start asking, talking to people about it, and a lot of people don't give when they can't. In other words, they hold back God's part just in case, and then if things don't work out, God doesn't get His. And it's surprising. But yet, as we look at Judah, and we look at God's indictment of Judah, Judah isn't concerned with this is right, and no matter what happens to me, if it's right, then I'm okay. Most believers really are not like, all I care about is being right. I don't really care about consequences. In other words, if being right costs me everything, so be it. At least I get to be right. Judgment. Oppression is the opposite of it. In other words, if you take advantage of God or take advantage of someone else, but righteousness is something that we ought to desire. So that's the state of affairs in Isaiah's ministry. Isaiah is already a prophet of God. But he is pointing to a transition. As we look to understand tonight Isaiah's ministry, understand chapter 6, Isaiah is pointing to a transition point in his life. You ever been through transitions? I have. I can think of several phases in life where things really transition, things really change. One for me would have been kind of the time about when I was about to graduate from Bible college. And it really was transitioning, and it was a lot of, like, trivial, important things to me, but, trivial in the whole scene of life and so forth. Master's or ministry? Do I work on getting my master's degree, or do I go into ministry? And since there's, like, no significant other in my life right now, should I, try to put myself in the way of finding someone, or should I leave that to you think trivial things, but, important to me. It was a time of period in my life, and I think back to that. When I graduated from Bible college, and I came to a conclusion, I just want God to have all of me. I have my dreams, my hopes, my expectations, the things I plan. I wanted to be a church planter since I was a teenager. I wanted I wanted to be a preacher since I was a child. Plans and dreams and all these things. But I came to a place when I said, you know, I just want to serve God. And it's amazing how God just took my course and just veered it. I always thought, you think this is funny maybe, but I always thought I'd be a church planter in Kansas. I had to drive 30 miles every day to go to school, to a Christian school, and 30 miles to go to church on Sundays. Now, I know some of y'all think Kansas is so desolate that you got to go 30 miles, you know, just to get to the corner of your street or whatever. But the fact of the matter is I lived in a town of 50 to 60,000, and I drove to a town of 7,000 to go to church because we didn't have a good one in our town at the time. So I just felt like, well, you know, naturally God's going to help. You know, I'm going to plant a church when I graduate from college. That's what I thought God would want. But God put in my life a certain sequence or series of events that definitely put that on hold. And so I came to a place in my life when I said, you know, all I want is what God wants. Actually, what are my dreams? What are my hopes and expectations? What are my plans? Really just need, I actually just need to be on board with God on this thing. And so I just said, God, whatever you want. And God put in me a burning passion just to serve, just to do ministry. And I kind of put it out there. Met a couple of pastors at different places. I said, you know, all I'm looking for is a place to serve. I don't need anything from anybody. I just want to serve the Lord. If you've got a way that you can show me that I could serve the Lord, I'll come to your ministry or whatever. Ended up in South Florida because of that. Ended up at West Park Baptist Church. Ended up having put into my heart something I never had seen before. I'd never seen an area like this with this few good churches. God just ended up changing all kinds of things. Never met someone like my wife before. And met her in that. And God just did so many wonderful things. So many just amazing things. Because all I wanted was, I said, God, I don't need to plant a church in Kansas. I don't need to get my master's degree. I don't need this. I just need whatever is right, whatever is your plan, whatever righteousness is. And so I'd been saved before that. I'd surrendered to the Lord's will before that. I'd done a lot of things, but that was a transition point for me in ministry. In many ways, I see, for Isaiah, I see the death of King Uzziah and this encounter that Uzziah has with the Lord as one of those transition times. Isaiah's not saying, you know, it occurred to me to be a prophet at the time. This is not Isaiah, you know, initially, oh, you know, who are you, God? Oh, yeah, okay, I worship you. Oh, you'd like me to be a prophet? Okay. No, Isaiah's already serving the Lord. And yet, there's a time, something is happening in his life where there's an encounter with God. And I think all of us ought to be familiar with what God said and the way things work. So let's look at the text. Look at verse 1. The Bible says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphims. Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face, and with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. You'll notice in Daniel and in Revelation, you'll see the same description of the seraphims. So this is really, if you could picture this in your mind, this is the scene in the throne room of heaven where God is sitting. The verse 3, the Bible says, one cried unto another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. Now that is interesting, is it not? Would anyone take exception with the phrase, the whole earth is full of his glory? It doesn't seem like it sometimes, does it? And yet the whole earth shows the glory of the Lord. And so the Bible says in verse 4, and the post of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. My friend, when you come to a place of an encounter with God, the first thing that you're going to recognize is His glory. And the second thing that will point you to is what we see in verse 5, and that is your own unworthiness. Isaiah said, then said I, woe is me, for I am undone, because I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Now keep in mind that God is about to call Isaiah. Specifically, he's about to get a higher calling, a more specific calling. But the thing that happens first is that Isaiah has an encounter with God that helps him to recognize that the earth is filled with God's glory. And when I recognize that, I recognize that I'm not filled with God's glory. I'm not. God is holy, holy, holy. A Hebraism. And we see even in the New Testament of the Scripture, a description that shows us the literal attributes, the characteristics of God, and the emphasis of it. When something would be said once, it would be true. If it's said twice, it would be very true. But in the Hebrew, if it's said three times, it's just, this is just a sacred truth that is inseparable from any other concept, or it is set apart. And God's holiness just completely sets Him apart from comprehension of man, from being able to relate to anything or anyone but God. And Isaiah said, "Then said I, woe is me, for I am undone." I want to say about the ministry, this is Isaiah's call to the ministry, I want to say about the ministry that there is no one worthy of it. When you recognize who calls you to the ministry, and you recognize God's plan in the ministry, what's God's plan in the ministry? Help me to understand it, would you please? Make sure we're on the same page. What's the ministry? What does the word ministry mean?
Service.
Okay, service. Yeah, doulos. It's like kind of like being a slave or a servant. So the ministry is service to whom? For whom? For God. So the ministry is service to God, right? Serving God. All right. Today, does God have a pretty detailed, well laid out, specific plan of what He's doing?
Yeah.
What's He doing?
Ephesians 4.
What?
Ephesians 4.
Ephesians 4. Okay, He gave gifts unto men. He gave some apostles and prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers for the work of the ministry. For the
edifying the body of Christ.
For the edifying of the body of Christ. No, it's for the something and then the edifying of the body of Christ. What? For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. So what's God doing? Well, that's kind of the ministry. What are the last words of Jesus in every instance?
Go preach the gospel.
So what's God doing?
Reconcile men to Himself.
Okay. Boy, you're so technical. He's saving people. Reconciling men unto Himself. That's what God's doing. Does anybody know what God's doing? Why is God not judging the world and destroying it right now? What?
Long-suffering.
Because He's long-suffering. He's being merciful. What does He want to happen? For people to be saved. What else is God doing specifically? How is He doing it, or what is He doing it with?
Holy Spirit.
No, His church. Can somebody please talk about the church for just a minute? God is all about the church. Jesus died for it. He loves it. Y'all never talk about it when I ask these questions. It frustrates me sometimes. Jesus said, "I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." The ministry is the preaching of the gospel, and God's doing it with the church. So what's God all about?
The church.
He's all about the church. Thank you, Tati. Very good. It's all about His church. Okay, so when you recognize what the church is, are you ever overawed by God's love for it? How long does it take you to be in a church to find out it's filled with sinners? Yeah, not too long. I could find sinners in seconds. I could find fault very, very quickly. Can't you? Isn't there fault? Sure, yeah. But God said, Jesus said that the church is His bride. He's going to sanctify her. He's going to cleanse her so He can present her to Himself without spot, without wrinkle. It occurred to me some years past that if the church is Jesus' idea, it must be a pretty good one. Right? In other words, we're always repurposing and redefining the church. When you knock on doors and you invite people to church, what do they say? I have church in me. That's a redefinition of church, actually. That isn't what Jesus said the church was. Right? I get mailers. I got some today. Sometimes I do read like a lot of things, even though it's not worth reading a lot of times. I read everything. It's just a habit that I got into when I was a child. So sometimes I read them before I throw them away. But I'm going to just tell you something. Believers who ought to know better have some ridiculous concepts for what a church is and how to build it. I mean, the reason I say it's ridiculous is because it has nothing to do with what God said the church is. Church really ought to be, if you'll pardon the vernacular, it ought to be a gospel preaching machine. It ought to be a discipling machine. I mean, it ought to be cranking people through it, through teaching people to observe all things, preaching the gospel, baptizing. I mean, it just those ought to be happening in a good church, shouldn't they? But what usually church growth seminars are all about is how to engage, you know, the generation that's leaving the church, the people that are saved, how to, you know, successfully. Most churches' growth model is to be the best at programming so that people will choose your church over someone else's church. Honestly, that is the growth model of the megachurch. Be better at things, which means that if your church is going to be chosen over another church, it means that another church is going to die. So let's kill your church to build ours. That's what we usually think. But we don't usually think about it as a gospel preaching machine. I'm going to tell you something. I don't think that you could find many people in Broward County that think that the lost people in Broward County could all be saved and become the church. Do you realize that? Not many people who want to plant churches think lost people are going to get saved, they're going to grow, and they're going to be the church. They usually just think we're going to start a church and that, you know, everything is wrong with the other churches we're going to be right about. And so I'll be honest with you, a lot of my church planting friends who are good people and who are doing a good work and it's needed are making up for a lack of what another ministry isn't doing. In other words, a church goes south in its music, and so another church starts and they have good music. And so the people that, you know, aren't comfortable with the bad music come to this church. And is that okay? Is that bad? No, but is it the purpose of the church? No, it isn't really. You know, our church has gone seeker sensitive. I know when I was in college, the church we went to, man, I'll tell you, we grew. We grew from about maybe 20 people to, I don't know, 100 and, I don't know, maybe 120 or so in about 6 months' time. It was like really fast growth. And maybe four or five of those people had gotten saved in that time. They just, you know, they found out, hey, that church is doing a good job over there, and they came to our church instead of the churches they were frustrated with. In other words, I'm not saying that's wrong or that's bad, but friend, if we want to understand what the ministry is, we have to understand that what God is doing is a very amazing thing. And when you understand what God is doing and then you realize that God wants to use us to do it, it ought to cause you to say, woe is me, for I'm undone. I'm a person of unclean lips, and I dwell among a people of unclean lips. I'll tell you, when the Holy Spirit looks at me and God deals with me and I'm transparent, I say, search me, God, know my heart. Show me any wicked way in me. God does it. Does he do that for you too? He says, you're pretty lousy. You're pretty awful. And I start feeling pretty down about it, and then I realize, yeah, not only am I lousy, but I'm rubbing shoulders with a bunch of people that are made of the same stuff. We all are. And friend, that's an important part in your call to ministry. Important call of the ministry is coming to a place when you recognize that God's glory fills the earth, that God's ways are glorious, and that God's plan is above and beyond, and that the fact of the matter is that your qualification is not because you're anything like God, it's because you are called. Now don't misunderstand me. There are qualifications for the bishop, aren't there? There are standards for the believer, aren't there, in the Word of God? There are things the believer... Do you think Isaiah might have met the qualifications to be a prophet when God called him? Do you? I mean, do you think he was living a risque lifestyle? Absolutely not. He was a good man. He was a prophet of God. He was serving the Lord. And while he was serving the Lord, Uzziah died, and he had an encounter with God that took him to the next level of ministry. So this is not Isaiah, you know, coming to a point of revival necessarily. It's just Isaiah having a transitional call in the ministry. God's about to do something great. And the first thing that happens to Isaiah is he recognizes that he's unworthy. I love the picture in verse 6. The Bible says, then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs from off the altar. And he laid it upon my mouth and said, lo, this hath touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin purged. Now, friend, the pictures here, of course, are of the cleansing blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. In verse 8, we find that Isaiah is relieved. Now, did Isaiah do anything to correct his standing with God? He said, woe is me, my lips were not clean. Did Isaiah do anything to correct that? The closest thing you could say Isaiah did was that he acknowledged who he was. He said, I'm unclean. I'm undone. What can a guy who's unclean and undone accomplish for God? Yeah, not much of anything, can he? He's all loose ends. He's a basket case. And that's Isaiah. He says, he's already a prophet of the Lord. He's already served under Uzziah as a prophet. And he realizes God's glory is so great and His glory is so prominent throughout the world. What am I? I'm undone. Woe is me. And then God does something for him. He has an angel take a coal from a fire and puts it on his lips, purges his lips. And it's a picture, of course, my friend, of the fact that sometimes we can, in our pride, think that we measure up to God's standard. No one ever has. It's a dangerous place to be, and it's a futile attempt to try to measure up to God. It's a very humble place to realize that it is Christ's righteousness that we have. Too many Christians get frustrated and burn out of the ministry because they try to measure up instead of realizing that they're made worthy by the blood of Jesus. If you'll find your self-esteem, by the way, self-esteem, you know, someone who is down on themselves or down on or up on themselves, if they will. If a person has a high self-esteem or a low self-esteem, you know what I'm talking about, don't you? Feel like, you know, I'm just not good enough. And other people feel like, you know, I'm plenty good enough. Whatever it is. We literally have confused generations trying to teach young people self-esteem. You know, the everybody's a winner kind of a mentality, mindset. There's nobody who doesn't measure up. Everybody's good enough. Believe in yourself, that sort of thing. I just want to tell you something. A believer who finds his worth any other place than in the righteousness of Jesus Christ has an esteem of himself that makes very little of who Jesus is and very much of who he is. And I don't think that would be a good way to esteem oneself. We're not to esteem ourselves more highly than we ought to think, are we? As well, a person who would esteem themselves as worthless when God has invested the blood of Jesus Christ in them. And to say, I'm not good enough, I don't measure up. I can't. Isaiah could have stayed in a state where he would say, I'm not good enough to serve God. And would any of us disagree with him about that? If Isaiah were to say, I'm not good enough for God, would anyone disagree? Would anyone say, well, Isaiah, step aside. Step back and I'll step up because I am good enough. No. You have to find your worth in what Jesus has done for you. When you recognize the inestimable value of the blood of Jesus Christ and recognize that it was shed for you, you realize your worth. Whereas I'm not worth something because of something I've done. I'm worth what I am because of what God has invested in me. If I were to take my pickup truck and fill it full of gold coins, I'll bet you there's a lot of people here that would give me, you know, more than market value for my truck. Wouldn't you? Why? Because you're Dodge fans? How many Dodge fans do we have here tonight? Mike, you a Dodge fan? Yeah, we got Mike. Good for you. You're the only Dodge fan in the building. I got a Dodge and I'm not even a fan. This truck, kind of truck. You know, some people, like Ford people, they're really crazy. Ford people are like, you know, Ford, they say things like built Ford tough, which means it breaks down all the time, things like that. But there aren't as many Dodge fans out there. So, Brother Al, I haven't picked on you all night, have I? Not even once. Can you see me?
I like it.
Okay. All right. So you maybe wouldn't give me anything for my truck because it's a Dodge, but if it was full of gold coins, you'd think it's worth something, wouldn't you?
Depends if you leave the gold coins.
What's that?
Depends if you leave the gold coins.
Oh yeah, that would be just my truck. And I'd leave like my trash in it too. You know, you get the whole thing, package deal, everything. Scratches, grease stains, everything. See, my friend, if you and I come to a place when we realize our unworthiness, but we also realize that our qualification to serve God is in what Christ has invested in us. We're not going to have this question of, am I worthy? You want to ask me, you come to me anytime, you ask me, am I worthy of the ministry? My answer will be, certainly not. No, you're not. I don't care who you are. I don't care how much better than me you are, or how much better you are than someone else. You're not worthy. If you ask me, are you worthy of the ministry? My answer will be, absolutely not. Certainly not. But my friend, I've been cleansed. And God has invested in me something. That is the blood of His Son. God didn't save me to live out my life to its end, whatever way that I should deem fit. God saved me to serve Him. And that's what the ministry is. Isaiah's already been called to the ministry. He realizes he isn't qualified for the ministry, but God cleanses him for the ministry. And you and I ought to understand that the qualification process is a continual cleansing. I certainly think that there would have been days when Isaiah wouldn't have said, woe is me, for I'm undone, and he wouldn't have had to have. And yet here he meets the character, holy character and nature of God, and he's undone. And when he's purged, then God sends him or calls him. In verse 8, also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, who shall I send, and who will go for us? Then said I, here am I, send me. Have you ever thought of the audacity of those words? Has it ever occurred to you how audacious it is that God is looking at a nation of people and He said, I want judgment and there is none. I want righteousness and there isn't any. Isaiah has an encounter with the holy character of God. He sees the train, the temple of God, sees the place where God is sitting. And he says, woe is me, I am undone. And then minutes later, or in the same conversation, he says, here am I, send me. You know, we think about a lot of times as surrender, don't we? Like, until this time, you know, Isaiah, you know, was going to live his life for himself. He was going to do his own thing, but here when God said, oh, I don't have anyone, who am I going to send? Would anyone please volunteer? And Isaiah said, I will. This isn't how it happened at all. Isaiah saw the holy presence of God. He says, woe is me, I'm undone, I'm unclean. I dwell in the midst of a people, I'm a person of unclean lips. I live among a people of unclean lips. Nobody around here is worth anything. And God cleansed him. And at his cleansing, the same man who said, woe is me, I'm undone, said, I'll go. In other words, the question really is, who is qualified? Do you see it in the text this evening? The question is, who shall I send? Who will go for me? And Isaiah said, I'll do it. And that's rather much of a switch, isn't it? From what he'd said just before. Right before this, Isaiah says, woe is me. And now he says, send me. If you ever want to understand God's call in your life, you need to come to the same place that you recognize that in and of yourself, you and I, we're nothing. But when you come to the place where you come to the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ, you recognize that the effect of the blood is to make us literally not just God's children, but heirs together with Christ. You recognize that you instantly are royalty, qualified not by your own righteousness, but by the righteousness of Jesus Christ. What right do you have? What right do you have to tell anybody they're a sinner? You know, some Christians have a hang-up preaching the gospel just because they don't want to condemn anybody. I remember being with a man one time, and he said, you pointed at that guy, Pastor. We went soul winning. He'd just gotten saved. He's excited about the gospel. He said, you know, you pointed at him and said, you need to be saved. And he said, I just don't think you should point at somebody like that. Now, perhaps in polite society, you don't point, you know, these sort of things. Maybe it's bad etiquette and some sort of thing. But he said, you know, I just really felt like you were condemning him. And in many senses, what he was saying was, I really feel like you shouldn't have told him in such strong terms that he was a sinner in need of a Savior, because you're kind of like, you're bad. And who has the right to tell anybody they're a sinner? Who does? Anyone who is covered with the blood of Jesus. Isn't it sacrilegious or a pious I shouldn't say sacrilegious. That isn't a pious position to tell somebody that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You know what? It isn't even so important that we include ourselves. You know, I always try to say we when I talk about, you know, all have sinned. I always ask people first, am I a sinner? You know, that way they can call me a sinner before I call them one. But the reality of it is I'm covered by the blood of Jesus, my friend. I'm covered by the blood. I don't pretend to think that I measure up in my flesh to what God wants me to do, but there's nothing wrong with God's work in me. Qualified. I'm qualified to preach the gospel simply because I've received it. And Isaiah was qualified to say, I'll go. You're mine, send me. Not because of what he'd done, but because he'd been cleansed for the work. Isn't that wonderful? My friend, that is one of the most liberating truths a servant of the Lord Jesus could ever come to find. Verse 9. So here's the commission then. He said, go and tell this people, hear ye indeed, but understand not, and see ye indeed, but perceive not. So, yes, you can hear, but no, you don't understand. Yes, you can see, but no, you can't. And we're not talking about cataracts. Then the Bible says, make in verse 10, the heart of this people fat, make their ears heavy and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and convert and be healed. God said, okay, this is your choice. Let me help you with your choice. Let me read to you 2 Thessalonians. You're taking notes this evening. You may want to make a note or a cross-reference from verse 10 of Isaiah 6, because this is a helpful passage of Scripture. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 9, this is, of course, talking about future events. Bible says, even him, in verse 9, whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs and lying wonders and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish. Notice the causal statement at the end of verse 10. Because they received not the love of truth that they might be saved. And verse 11 says, and for this cause God shall send them a strong delusion that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth. Why is it, what is the cause for God to cause people to be delusioned, to believe a lie? Well, the answer is in verse 10. Because they received not the love of the truth that they might be saved. To whom is Isaiah called? Well, he's called to a people who, instead of judgment, give oppression. Instead of righteousness, give a cry. What is their choice when it comes to God? What's their choice? They've chosen to reject Him, haven't they? And God said, I'm going to help you reject Me. We are going to, if you will, accelerate this outcome that's coming your way. It's just similar to Pharaoh when you see Pharaoh in Exodus chapter 5 making a decision to rebel against God and say, who is the Lord? And God said, I'll show you who I am. And God does similarly with him, where he makes his heart fat, the Bible says, ears heavy, and shuts the eyes. In verse 11, Isaiah asked the question, then said, Lord, how long? Well, how long? What in answer to what? Well, how long, God, are you going to do this with your people? How long is this judgment going to be for your people? How long, if this is how long God is going to judge his people, the second question that Isaiah's how long is asking is, how long do I have to have this ministry? God said, who will go and tell people, hearing, seeing ye see not, hearing ye hear not? Your heart's going to grow fat. You're not going to hear with your eyes. Your ears are going to be heavy. I'm going to prolong this. And Isaiah said, how long do I have to have this kind of ministry? Let me help you understand something, friend. We live in the age of the Holy Spirit. And I believe firmly, and I believe it based on the Scripture and on my personal experience, that God's in the business of saving souls. Is anyone in agreement about that? Listen, the truth of the matter is, if we went more, we'd see more people saved. That's the way it is. If we preached the gospel more, we'd have more people saved. Whenever we make a pointed effort to preach the gospel, people get saved. When I just go out just soul winning, in other words, I'm not just casually encountering people and preaching the gospel, but I'm actually out seeking people to preach the gospel to. For instance, when I'm doing door-to-door, I've learned not to waste too much time on people that want to argue or just aren't interested, because I know there's someone who is. I always just try to get to that person as quickly as I can and spend my time with that person instead of spending my time trying to give answers. You know, sometimes people are asking questions. You think they're just giving you a hard time, but maybe they actually want to know answers to questions. But a lot of times, you know, you're just debating or arguing with someone when there's actually someone who had received the gospel. And I'm looking for that person, and there are a lot of them, my friend. There are so many lost people in this world who, if they just heard the gospel, would receive it. I believe that with all my heart. I don't know what the proportions are and what the numbers are. Here's something that's interesting. We have 1,000 of those basketball flyers, and I'm hoping that statistically they'll do better than our door hangers do. Here's our door hangers, and they will because we're going to get a targeted audience. We're going to go into the schools and give them to the kids. But you know when we pass out door hangers? Did you know that for every 1,500 door hangers we get one visit? Within 6 months. Sometimes longer than that, but the average is, back when I used to do the averages, and I doubt it's changed much. It used to be if I pass out 1,500 door hangers, somebody would visit the church within 6 months. Okay, now, if you're a business person and you recognize that model, what could you do? Here's the way I think about it. If I passed out 1,500 door hangers a day, I could have 7 visitors a week. They'd start coming at least within 6 months period of time from when I started passing out the door hangers. So if we really wanted to just get people to know about our church and come here, we could pass out 1,500 door hangers a day. Let's just do it 6 days a week. Take, you know, a Sunday to worship the Lord. So 6 days a week, we could have 6 visitors a week every 6 months. Could you build a church that way? Sure could. Does anybody have any idea how much labor is in 1,500 door hangers?
Depends on the neighborhood.
What's that?
Depends on the neighborhood.
Taj, how many did we do when we did our days where we limped home? Do you remember? How many did we do a piece? 1,000 a piece?
1,000
a piece. So, no, some of us did more than that.
I did the least out of you guys.
How many did you do?
600.
Well, no wonder we only got 1/6 of a visitor. Or 6/10 of a visitor. Huh. Anyway, we went out one day and we were just, you know, trying to get out 3,000 flyers. That's a lot of work for one person. Now, I found that 6 people can do it pretty quick, about an hour. It's amazing how fast if you have somebody dropping people off and picking them up and doing it, how quickly you can do it. You know, if we were really serious about engaging our community, we'd do something like that. And we've done it for periods of time. It's hard to sustain, actually. It's difficult. But it actually works. It actually works. You know what we always thinking about when we're doing that? Like, how long we have to do this? Right? How long? Are we going to do this forever or just, you know, for a week? I always have to give our people an end date to something. We're going to do something. We're going to go out and kill ourselves, but we're going to quit killing ourselves at this point in time. Just so people have something to look forward to. Well, Isaiah asked God, how long, God, am I going to have the ministry of preaching to people that their ears and their hearts and all this negative things are going to happen? And in verse 12, the Bible says, or the answer is in verse 11, and he answered, until the cities be wasted without inhabitant, and the houses without man, the land be utterly desolate, and the Lord have removed men far away, and there be a great forsaking in the midst of the land. So, first, until everybody's gone. You're going to have the ministry preaching to the people until they're gone. That's the first answer. That's a summary, but it's a good enough one. Anyone want a longer one, or is that good enough for you? You'd like a longer one, Bella? Okay, Mrs. Price will give you one on the way home. Nobody else wants me to go any longer. All right. Verse 13. Mrs. Price is like, no! Make him stop. But yet in it, verse 13, shall be a tenth, and it shall return, and shall be eaten as a tail tree and as an oak whose substance is in them when they cast their leaves. You don't know who it is, so it won't hurt if I tell a story. The lady that visits here sometimes, one time, and I think it was January, I said, Pastor, the trees are dying. What are they? They're black olives, Al? These nasty trees we have in our parking lot. And I just thought, oh, if only they were. She said, Pastor, the trees are dying. She pointed at the trees. They were shedding all their leaves. Well, in Florida, it's kind of weird when the trees shed their leaves because they don't turn color. And while they're shedding their leaves, other trees grow on, or leaves grow back on. But they were shedding their leaves. And she said, the trees are dying. I thought, oh, if only they were, you know. And the fact of the matter is that they were not. But north of here, And even with the cypress trees. Have you ever seen a cypress tree that looks dead? Cypress trees a lot of the year look dead, don't they? Like, we have these cypress trees that parrots lived in outside of our condos. And I'll be honest, when I was first there, a guy told me, he said, that tree's dead. They need to cut it down. And it looked dead until whatever the time of the year was, and it turned all green and started growing. And God said, I'm going to have in Judah, I'm going to make the land look desolate, but there's going to be life, a tenth. Now, we can make a significance out of the tenth or that percentage if God said there was a significance, but God just said the tenth, and the tenth is a remnant. In other words, it's a small part. And that is the way that God looks at what we give Him when He blesses us. He gave me a tenth, that's just a token or a small part. And God said there's going to be a token. And we saw in Revelation last week, and it's called a remnant in Revelation. It's called remnant in chapter 10 of Isaiah as well. God said, I'm going to leave a remnant, something that is there, even though it looks like it's dead. I want to remind you about something. God saves Jews. Matter of fact, there are more Jews saved probably that God knows about than we have any idea of. So it's very interesting when I go to, not just, you know, we're in a pretty Jewish area. So on a Sunday morning, usually there are people who are saved Jews that actually attend our services. Every church I've been to in South Florida, that's been the way. But you know, it's true in North Florida, in the North and other places as well. You'd be surprised how many Jewish people. In Kansas, we had Jewish people in our church. They were Jewish, but they were believers. They weren't practicing Jews, but they're Jewish, and God knows it, and they did too. Proportionately, 10 out of 100 is a pretty small minority, but God said, I've got a minority. I don't know if that's the number today. I'm not trying to make up some kind of teaching or doctrine about how many believing Jews there are today. But I'm going to tell you something. God has something to work with. It's so silly sometimes when the church began at Jerusalem for us to think that Jews don't get saved. It's really nonsensical, actually, when you think about it, isn't it? So how many Jews will get saved out of 100 that you go through the gospel with? Well, I don't know, but you could hope for 10. God said in the Scripture, God says here in the Scripture that yet in it shall be a tenth, and it shall return, and shall be eaten as a teal tree and as an oak, whose substance is in them when they cast their leaves, so the holy seed shall be the substance thereof. God said to Isaiah, though it would seem that your ministry is to a people of unclean lips, you're personally aware of somebody whose lips have been cleansed. And Isaiah, there will be a remnant of individuals who will believe. I want to remind you the last thing about the ministry is that it's not futile. The ministry isn't a waste of time. Sometimes we look at the investment and we think, oh, you know, we hope that this would happen with this person and this person and this person, and then we find out that they didn't. You know, this. But y'all, just tell you something. God does a work. And He works with people that are cleansed, that are yielded, and that say, here am I, I'll go. And with that, God has what to Him is an acceptable remnant. Sometimes we look at what God's doing and we think, oh, it should be so much more. How many people ought to receive Christ? Everybody should, right? How many do? Not nearly as many as ought to. Does God know what He's doing? Has He got the ministry figured out pretty well?
Yes. Super.
God knows what He's doing, and He has things figured out. And we just need to make sure we're part of His plan. And that was Isaiah's call to the ministry. He was already in the ministry, and yet he had this encounter with God. And we'll see from here forward, we're going to see that God is going to really use him as a prophet, really use him for some special things. Right in the next chapter, we see the prophecy when Ahaz won't ask God and won't tempt the Lord. And he gives a prophecy of the Messiah. Isaiah had a great ministry. It came from a place when he saw the glory of God, when he recognized what he was, when he was cleansed, and then when he responded to God's call. And I have to say that Isaiah had a very fruitful ministry, and so can you and I if we'll follow that same footprint. Father, thank you so much for what you showed us in your word this evening. I ask you to help us to absorb it and to, Lord, to really enact it in our lives, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You're dismissed.
About prayer requests.
We already did.